Hello everybody, Dazis here. Happy to see everybody on the other side of the screen. And today I have a tutorial about troubleshooting pumps. Why I selected the subject? There's the actual reason why. Pumps troubleshooting, pumps problems. Probably number one subject that creates false positives, which means that customers think that pump is faulty, why it's not. Sometimes it's even result return of the product, but when we check, nothing wrong with it, so we have to deal about returning back the same thing, and it's create unnecessary stress for everybody involved in that. So I hope this video will help things to troubleshoot. It's also easier to explain it on a video rather than type couple paragraphs of text, because every time I try to help my clients to troubleshoot it to avoid unnecessary commotions, but over the email it's a little bit harder than in this tutorial video, which I hope I will finish up successfully, because every 5 seconds seems that somebody tried to deliver some products to our warehouse. So anyways, that's besides the point. I would like to break situation when you might have experienced problems with pump in two parts. One part is initial building of your system, so you just receive your things, you try to fill your system and it doesn't work. And second, when you run your system for some time and all of a sudden something happened and you think maybe it's pump problem. So, initial setup. The number one reason, it's totally stupid and you probably wouldn't believe me, but it's true. The number one reason why initial pump problems appears is because of this very old legacy connector that comes with most of the pumps. So you can see this is a Molex 4-pin connector. It's quite flimsy. Lots of people dislike it. Very common situation when somebody connecting it to power supply didn't connect it properly, didn't insert it properly. So basically just no power delivery period. And obviously pump doesn't work, doesn't spin. I can't count how many times I said, listen, try to wiggle your cables, try to make sure it works. Maybe that's your problem. And people just, oh my God, yes. So definitely before you do any other locomotions, check your connections, that you have a power, that your power supply works, that your power supply is on, and the connection itself as well. Also, a side note, a lot of people saying like, why pumps use this Molex connector instead of, let's say, using something more convenient, for example, can be this connector from the fan or maybe even SATA. The reason actually is because of the rating of the connection. Some pumps are relatively powerful devices. They can be like 50 watts, 40 watts type of the product, and it's not rated for safety on a small connector. So the big connector is rating is several amps, so everybody want to be make sure they no fire, nothing. So that's the reason why this connector is still alive and still used in use. Everybody hate it, but that's the situation. So power delivery is number one. Second thing is also a little bit stupid situation when people don't pay attention to where the tube, where the liquid should be get in and where liquid should be get out of the your pump device, or it can be top for the pump or it can be full assembly like this reservoir and pump combo. Typically, in order to provide flexibility, customers provide multiple ports. So you have like one hole, second hole, third hole, sometimes you have like 5 holes in the system. People just connect whatever they want, don't pay attention how the actual liquid goes inside of the pump top. And it's quite common that people connect both inlet and outlet to two inlets or two outlets, and obviously there's total blockage, nothing happens. So you need to pay attention how you connect your pump. The reason for that why it's not universal, it's just how pump works. So we have this impeller, that the thing is spinning inside of the pump, and typically you have a water coming into the middle, and after that there's a centrifuge force by spinning this impeller thingy. It's basically water pushed aside, and inside of the housing for the pump usually you have a escape at the edge of the pump housing that your pump and water get out, and it's obviously have exit somewhere. So that's, you need to pay attention again that exit is this thing and inlet in other thing. So it's very simple thing to do. All you need to do in this situation, just double check your manual and you're golden. So if that's still okay, your power is okay, you probably even can feel that pump is kind of humming and spinning, and definitely your connections on the pump or pump reservoir combo is correct, but you still don't have a flow. So then you start thinking, maybe pump just not powerful enough or something wrong with the pump and it doesn't go. Well, this could be another situation which a little bit tricky, but it's very common. So it happens, from my personal experience, probably every third build for me have this problem, and that called air lock. So what's happening with that is typically it's happening inside of the radiator. So in the radiator you have inlet, outlet, and water coming through the hub of the radiator, turning, coming back, and exit. So sometimes I can't even pinpoint what position and what kind of configuration triggers more than other, but nevertheless, it happens. Sometimes the water gets pushed inside of the radiator and the air not escaping for whatever reason properly, and pump keep pushing, compressing air to a certain degree, but at some point the pressure from the compressed air and the pressure from the pump equalize, so they stop, pump works full speed, but nothing happening. Or another situation where sometimes actually it's kind of barely dripping. So the airlock is holding most of it, but allow just a little bit of barely moving liquid. How to deal with this? First of all, try to plan your loop so it will be more or less cascading, more or less without unnecessary loops and restrictions. For example, cross-flow radiators typically don't create a situation like this when you have an inlet and outlet totally on opposite sides. So what will happen, you just get radiator get filled with liquid and air get pushed out and you get out. It's not 100% guarantee because you might have a kind of more restriction down the road, but nevertheless you make sure to check that you don't have airlock. And how to deal with this, it's a lot of tutorial. In two words, I would say that typically I try to a little bit shake the system. If it helps, I try to stop and start my pump, so it's kind of changing pressure inside of the system. Sometimes you get pushed through. Obviously, dual pump setups less prone to this because it's just too much power. The thing that indicates that you might have a problem with airlock is the fact that pumps spin full speed. You probably, even if you have a RPM reporting, you can hear that or you can see clearly that it's whatever spinning 5000 RPM but nothing happening. That's your good clue that you have an airlock in your system. So pay attention to that. It's a little bit more tricky than other two, but it's very, very common, and we have to deal with a number of returns that basically was airlock at the end because the customer just didn't want to believe me or my other staff and just insisted on a return. So we have to take it back and prove that the system works. So now we're moving to the second situation when we have everything in use. And suddenly you see, maybe you have a flow meter, you can see that your flow dropped dramatically. So obviously most people start thinking that the fault on the pump side. Not necessarily. Again, the first clue you need to check that if you have RPM reporting, make sure that you see how fast pump is spinning. So if you still have a full speed, like whatever, a few thousand RPM, probably not the pump, it's something else. But again, what it could be. Old days, quite common situation was when people, everybody using soft tubing, like I have right here. Sometimes you have I have relatively straight runs everywhere, so it's impossible for tube to collapse. But sometimes you have a tube a little bit more longer runs, more intricate type of turns. Sometimes tube simply bend, collapse, and this restricts your flow. So first thing, if you have a soft tubing, make sure you inspect every single run, see if you have any collapse, which is create basically a restriction, and that's why water doesn't go through. So this is one situation. It's less possible those days because a lot of people dealing with hard tubes, and those probably typically not collapsing. But nevertheless, if you have a soft tubing, check on that. Second is maybe something going on with your blocks. This is a little bit tricky. Why? Is because, for example, look on my system right there. So I have a black acetal CPU block, and I have a fully metal block for GPU. So I can't even look inside and see if there's any bad stuff going on. So it's not visible. If you have acrylic blocks, that's a little bit easy because you might look and see through the plastic, is there any junk obviously accumulated in the middle of the block, and that may give you additional clue. But troubleshooting things of blockage is very, very difficult because essentially you need to drain your system, disassemble the loop, and physically open the blocks, which is a lot of work and not even guarantee that something going on there or not. My recommendation here would be only one. So if you would like to make sure it's not the pump, you still have to drain your system, but before you start unscrewing and looking inside of your blocks, I would suggest to take your pump or pump reservoir combo, fill it up, connect on itself, and make sure that actually that's worked. So if you have water going like crazy in a loop with zero restriction, that definitely pump works, and you have a situation probably more related to blockage, and then it makes more sense to open. So test pump first, as I said, in a little closed loop. If not, your only other resort is start basically taking everything apart and just open it up and see what's happening. Now, rare situation, but happened sometimes, that again, back to this flimsy connector. This connector, it has no latches, nothing. So over the time, if your system vibrating, or maybe you did something to your cables, like trying to connect new, I don't know, SSD or hard drive or additional fan, and sometimes you just shifting, touch the cables not in favorable way, and maybe you get disconnected. So also, if there are no RPMs, nothing, pump may be dead, or maybe again, it's simply the power singing. I even put electrical tape over SATA connectors just to make sure they never get disconnected by accident. So that's basically why pump maybe not bad, but you think it bad. But I would like to finish video with a couple ideas that definitely indicate on a pump failure. Number one would be probably if you smell a bad smoke, and actually the pump itself smells not good with the burnt wires, that probably the fault of the pump. It doesn't happen too often, almost never heard it's happening to D5 pumps. Sometimes it's happened with DDC pumps, and obviously it's happened more often with any Chinese fake pumps. But if you definitely smell the burn, or even have a plastic sometimes get burned through of the housing of the pump, then yeah, that's for sure. It's no clue, don't need to check anything else. Second fault for the pumps, that's not direct fault, but it's create problems with the noise. So sometimes pumps start like banging like crazy. So the pump itself, the motor electronic is still okay, but you have a problem with actual impeller part that's spinning in levitating magnetic field that most of the pumps house are made of. So you have electronic portion and you have a totally separate chamber with a magnet that spins an electrical field. So sometimes this part, it's partially magnet, partially plastic. Sometimes the middle part get wear off, or it could be defective from the beginning with, and it basically disbalance itself, and it's instead of spinning in perfect position, it start shaking and hitting the side of the pump that creates a lot of noise, which unpleasant. You don't need to buy new pumps if you can source impeller only, that will solve your problem. But how to see if that's the problem with impeller? For length pumps, DDC and D5 equally. All you need to do is assemble your pump, take the impeller out. If you see the round marks, scratches on the impeller and inside of this cavity, so it's plastic on DDC pumps and it's metal on D5 pumps, so if you see the scratches, that's it. So you can contact your store supplier, they might just send you impeller only, you don't need to return pump, your pump still continue to work fine, so you only need replacement part. So that's the most two common things why pump actually fail. So I hope this video helped you a little bit and maybe help you to be less involved in some unnecessary returns. And otherwise, I wish everybody a good weekend. It's a Friday for me. And going home and get some beers. See you soon.